I thought we'd talk about the laws of thermodynamics and maybe the second law in particular. So there are four laws. There are laws 1 to 3, and then there's law 0, which I suspect was slotted in after the first three laws. And it's actually sort of, in some sense, also the most trivial of them, which is why it's probably called the Zeroth Law. So the Zeroth Law just basically says, if you've got three bodies, call them A, B, and C, if A and B are in thermal equilibrium with each other, which is just a fancy way of saying they're the same temperature, which means if you put them together, no heat flows from one to the other. So if A and B are in thermal equilibrium, and if A and C are in thermal equilibrium, then B and C will be in thermal equilibrium. It does seem fairly obvious. It's a kind of a formal way of saying, really, there is only one definition of temperature, and that there is no way you can actually come up with a system where temperature is defined in a funny way such that one of these bodies has some peculiar property such that its temperature as far as body A is concerned is one thing, but its temperature as far as body C is concerned is another thing. And I think because it is sort of stating the obvious, I think that's why it's the Zeroth Law. So the first law is also fairly obvious in that it's basically a sort of restatement of the conservation of energy. In thermodynamics, there's kind of two sorts of energy. There's useful energy, which is work. So that's when you push something or whatever, that's, you know, that's sort of applying energy to it, and that's useful energy. And then there's useless energy, which is heat. And what the first law says is that if you've got a body and you apply a certain amount of work to it, so that's one sort of energy, and then you add a certain amount of heat to it, the total energy of that body will be whatever it was to start with, plus the energy you added from the work, plus the energy you added from the heat. So it's really just a statement of the conservation of energy, really. So there are kind of obvious laws, but you have to start with the basic building blocks in order to build up the entire subject of thermodynamics, and these are really the most fundamental building blocks. The third is difficult to talk about until we introduce a concept of a thing called entropy, which is to do with the disorder of a system. And the third law is basically saying that as you cool a system down towards absolute zero, the degree of disorder, so this quantity entropy, drops towards zero, or at least drops to a very low value. So classically, it'll drop to zero. There are some sorts of systems it'll just drop to a low value, but it will decrease until you get to absolute zero, and then it'll stop. So the second law has various formulations. The first formulations were put together really before this idea of entropy and disorder was invented, and they were very kind of operational definitions of it. So there are two classical statements of the second law of thermodynamics. The first is one due to a guy called Clausius, who said that heat won't travel from a cold body to a hot body. And that's sort of trivially known if you've just got a hot body and a cold body and you put them in contact with each other, the heat will flow from the hot thing to the cold thing, so they'll end up at the same temperature. They'll meet somewhere in the middle. And so it's kind of obvious if you're just doing, you know, putting things in contact with each other, but his statement is stronger than that, which is there is nothing you can do to make heat flow from a cold body to a hot body without putting some work in. So if you're prepared to inject some energy, you can make hot things colder and cold things hotter. A fridge is an example where you pump heat out of something which is already cold and add it to the air, which is warmer. So fridges, you know, in some sense, they violate the purest view of this view of this law, that you can't get heat to travel from something cold to something hot. But the get out is, but you're putting work in, so you're allowed to do it. So if you've just got an isolated system, you can't do it. It's a one-way street and there's no way around it, is the important point, that no matter how clever a machine you come up with, you can never make it so it will extract the heat from the colder thing and add it to the hotter thing without having to put some work in along the way. So that was Clausius' statement. And then there's the other statement, and that's in some sense, that's a sort of physicist statement, because that's about, you know, heat flow and observations of what happens when you put bodies in contact with each other. The second version of this is due to Lord Kelvin, and Kelvin's statement is more of an engineer's statement. This comes back to this fact that there are these two sorts of energy. There's kind of useful energy that you can do work with, and there's useless energy, heat, that you can't really do work with directly. And Kelvin's statement basically says that you can't turn heat directly into work. You can't just take heat and turn it into useful energy. Now, of course, again, you do this. A steam engine, for example, takes heat and turns it into work. But in order to do that, you have to have waste heat left over. So his statement is that you can't, again, have a kind of sealed box where you just put heat in at the top and the only thing that comes out is work. You're always going to have heat going in, work coming out, but then some waste heat coming out as well. There is a fundamental limit as to how little the amount of waste heat there is that you can get out of it, and you can figure out what that limit is, but it's always a finite amount. You can never reduce that to some completely infinitesimal or zero level. Those two things sound like completely different statements, right? They're talking about completely different things, but it turns out they're exactly equivalent to one another. And I can show you if you like. So the way we're going to do this is by saying if one of these versions of the second law isn't true, then the other one isn't true either. So let's violate Clausius' statement of the second law, which basically says you can't get heat to flow from the cold body to the hot body. So let's assume we have a magic fridge which violates that law by actually allowing us to suck energy out of the cold body, put it into the hot body without actually having to plug the fridge into the mains.
Okay.
And then on the over here, I'm going to just have an engine, like a steam engine or something, which doesn't violate any of the laws at all. And I'm going to take an amount of energy out of this hot body, U2. And because this isn't breaking any laws, there has to be some waste heat from it. So we'll set it up so that amount of waste heat is actually equal to Q1.
Keeping Lord Kelvin happy.
So yes, exactly, that's not violating any of the laws, and we're going to get some work out of this, which is just the difference between those two. This is the first law again that says that you have to conserve energy overall. So if we've got Q2 flowing in, then the amount of work we get out of there is just the difference between the two. Now, the neat part here is that what we've managed effectively to do, if I just draw a box around this little lot here, and say that's just going to be, I'm going to stick all that on in a box and I'm not going to care what's inside that box. And what that box is actually doing is it's taking an amount of energy, well, how much energy is coming in? It's taking heat out of this body, and it's taking an amount, well, there's Q2 flowing out and Q1 flowing back in, so the amount of energy that's coming out of this hot body is Q2 minus Q1, and this box, then the only thing that's coming out of it is work, Q2 minus Q1. So this now violates Kelvin's version of the second law, because actually all we've done in this process is we've taken an amount of heat out of this hot body and turned it directly into work, and Kelvin's statement of the law says you can't do that.
Professor, that shouldn't be a surprise, because we built the box by breaking the rules. We just broke Clausius's wording of the rules.
Exactly, but what we're trying to show is that those two statements of the second law are the same as each other. They're really stating the same law. And so, indeed, if they are the same law, you'd expect if you broke one version of the law, you'd break the other version of the law as well. But if they're actually different laws, or they're stating different things, then that wouldn't necessarily be the case. But that's kind of halfway there. That shows that if we violate Clausius's version, then we're violating Kelvin's version. But to really show they're equivalent, we've also got to show if we violate Kelvin's version, we're also violating Clausius's version.
Okay,
so Kelvin's version of the law says that you can't just turn energy into work. So you can't just take heat and turn it directly into work. There has to be a byproduct. So let's violate that by coming up with a magical engine which directly turns heat into work. An engine which does nothing but take this useless energy, heat, and turn it directly into useful energy, work. An infinitely efficient steam engine. So a real steam engine, there'd be waste heat coming out the bottom, but we're violating Kelvin's law here, so we don't have to do that.
Okay,
and then we're going to take that work and we're going to use it to power a fridge. And that fridge will, because this is now a proper fridge, it's not violating Clausius's law or anything, we can get it to work because we plugged it into the mains, and we can actually use it to suck energy Q2 out. So we can figure out how much heat's going to come out the other end. It's just going to be the two lots of energy going in as Q1 and Q2. So now if we just put a box around all this lot and say this is now my magic machine, and I don't really want to look inside the box, I just want to know what it's doing. What's happening? It's sucking an amount of energy Q2 out of the cold, and then on the hot side you've got Q1 coming out and Q1 plus Q2 going in, so the net amount of energy flowing into the hot is Q2. So effectively we created a machine here where with nothing, no extra external wires or anything, within that box it takes an amount of heat Q2 from a cold body and adds it to a hot body, and that violates Clausius's version of the second law. So what we've shown is that if Kelvin's version of the second law isn't true, then Clausius's version isn't true, and if Clausius's version of the second law isn't true, then Kelvin's version of the second law isn't true. And so just to kind of finish it off, so we've got these two laws, Kelvin's version and Clausius's version, and there's sort of four possibilities. They might both not be true, one might be true and the other one might be false, or the other way around, or they both might be true. And what we've ruled out by showing this is we've shown that if Kelvin's law is false, then Clausius's has to be false too, so it can't be true. If Clausius's version of the law is false, then Kelvin's can't be true, it has to be false as well. So we've ruled out those two in the middle. So the only two possibilities is they're either both wrong or they're both right. And that's just another way of saying that they're saying exactly the same thing. We haven't been able to prove that they're true, but we've shown that if one of them's true, the other's true, and if one of them's false, the other one's false. In other words, they're kind of equivalent to each other.
Lined up, which will keep it in an orbit, basically following the Earth around. There used to be lots of science fiction stories about L3. It used to be a popular place to put the anti-Earth, or, you know, if you're an evil genius, that's where you put your hidden lair